that D.Va as kind of a little anomaly, but we'll see how they take this approach.
Yeah, the 2-2-2 dive with Winston, D.Va coming out for Laser Kittens, instantly take the high ground and knock Cooler off that position. They're playing into triple tank as well, and that's going to be an instant pick onto the Lucio. Sets them up fairly well. It's all about target selection here for Reunited, making sure that they stay relatively healthy and then pick them off one by one from X-Rock.
I believe you did just say United, but it's Laser Kittens.
Oh yeah, of course, yeah, Laser Kittens.
We'll have to make sure we're casting the right teams here. Alex and Fuse are both going to go down, and Point A actually looks all but secured. Kib is basically untouched throughout that entire first fight, so really nice skills there across the board from Laser Kittens. I don't think maybe they lost a single player. If they did, I missed it, but the first attack was pretty much as clean as you could get it.
You know what that is? You know why I said United? Because they got Kib and Winghaven.
Indeed.
They're throwing me off, you know? These teams changing players, they're just trading. They're using these players like trading cards.
Oh, interesting. Cooler, I grabbed his POV just in time to see him switch off of Soldier onto Winston to try and defend the second point here. But the attackers are already coming in on the far side. Winston's going to dive straight onto Gray but get put to sleep. So Cooler's already removed from the fight. No kills piling up just yet. It looks like a majority of the battle is happening over by the spawn. D.Va suit explosion coming out from Nesh. Doesn't find anything. Alex actually got two kills and had a shield up in time. So I think defense are looking pretty strong here. Kib's Dragonblade maybe a little ill-advised, as it was just a bit late in the fight. After already losing a couple of teammates, he is going to get swatted down, and 6 minutes are left here for Laser Kittens to try and rally and make something happen.
I don't know why he invested the Dragon Blade there, because now he has to build a whole new one up, and Gray's got his Nana Boost that would have synced up quite nicely, and they definitely need ultimates like that to be able to get through the health pool here of X-Rocks. They're going for the quad tank defense in an attempt literally just to put too much health in the face of Laser Kittens, and then you had to use the Nana Boost instead onto Zapri. See if that gets through anybody. It's a bit, optimistic, I think, is the word that I was looking for there.
Yeah, maybe so. I think Fuse's Whole Hog ultimate actually put a shutdown on anything that was happening on the point, and then you've got enough mobility with Winston on the defense to basically grab up any fleeing attackers who might have been trying to escape with low health. So coordination looking pretty good here. We've got the attackers rallying once again. I'll take Winghaven and Kib actually likely going to be attacking the same targets, but Winghaven does have this Primal Rage, so we'll just follow along with him for now. Graviton Surge and Nano Boost available on the defense means this could just be a waste of a push. They may not want to commit any ultimates until they see if that Graviton is going to ruin their day or not.
Winghaven's starting to go forward, so Graviton is popped out onto Winghaven and Krems. They're actually using the Primal Rage as well there. He's surely going to get shredded. He's already incredibly weak, and Krems has fallen. So looks like Laser Kitten still wants to try and make this one happen. The Biotic. Biotic Grenade hitting onto Fuse and Alexi, but I don't think they're going to be able to get the picks unless they invest a ton more ults.
I'm looking at Nesh now. He's actually 3v1ing as Pharah, but I think that's only because, yeah, the bulk of his team is already dead. So as this fight kind of breaks down, I think defense are in no worries at all. They're Winston actually all the way out here. Cooler used his Primal Rage to knock away any, fleeing attackers and anyone trying to return to the fight. So if they can get that staggered kill on Zapri, which they do, that buys them another 20-25 seconds on the clock. 4 minutes left here for Nesh and company to try it again. Cooler's staying out here in the forum area. He's going to get absolutely annihilated.
I don't agree with that positioning nope. In general. Nesh is also going to have a bit of a field day if he can put out a ton of damage, but they need to select their targets very carefully here. It has to be getting onto Alexi or Xiao, and look at that Earth Shatter with the Nano Boosted Reinhardt. They're going to plow through.
Yeah, Nesh again, one of the last surviving people, so he's got lots of room to work with. He mentioned he was going to have a field day if they couldn't address him, but he's just the last alive in the two pushes that we watched so far, so I guess probably just needs to stick with the team a little bit more and assist them to actually get to the point rather than trying to find those healers as quickly as he has been trying to. Fuse has Whole Hog again, and we saw that was pretty destructive the first time around. If they combo it with a Graviton Surge here, that's a guaranteed one fight, basically, with no defensive ults on the other side. So we'll see now if that actually comes to fruition. We got the attackers approaching through the bridge now.
Another Graviton coming out here from Chao. He's really building these up incredibly quickly with all of the damage that's been done. Kib taking a Nana Boosted Dragon Blade, but he's about the only person able to do anything on his team, as that's a full wipe there. From Laser Kittens, they're having no success on this final push, and maybe they just have to wait for the Graviton. What do you think?
Yeah, the Graviton from the Defenders certainly worked out. They did exactly what we expected there with the Graviton plus Whole Hog. The Nano Blade actually got shut down completely over the course of that battle, so they're going to actually switch Kib over to Roadhog and Nesh off of Pharah onto Zarya. So heavy tank composition here, trying to actually just battle belly-to-belly against this defense, but they've got a nano boost to work with already, so defense still slightly favored, and they know exactly where the enemy team's going to be attacking through now on this cave side.
Important for Laser Kittens here that they try and push through and expend some ultimates out of X-Rocks without really putting anything in themselves, but they've used the sound barrier that only hit onto Krems and Nesh. Not quite sure how that one happened, but again, it looks like it's going to be X-Rocks with the better end of most of this fight.
That is a very tough angle to take a fight through if you don't have a CC ultimate. That Earthshatter came out so late. Nanoboost still getting committed here. These ults, why are they using so many ults after losing two or three people? I mean, I guess they have the numbers advantage literally on the point, 4-1 or 2, but the spawn is just so close. I don't think it was necessary. And again, you've got, who is this, the tank over here? Nesh and Kib actually both fall. That Reinhardt lasted so long. Wingshaven just swinging the hammer in circles there. But again, 90 seconds left. Now they've got two less ults to work with for their next attempt. I just don't know. Laser Kittens have had some iffy ones so far.
And again, Shao's been able to build up another Graviton. So now it's Graviton against Graviton because Nesh finally has one as well. They've been trying to run with that for about 2 minutes. I think it took him a solid 2 minutes to be able to build that up. And they've used a super aggressive Graviton there, Duffy.
Yeah, lots of defensive ults flying out in the open area, but it's definitely going to pay off as, again, Whole Hog plus Graviton is really all that's needed. So defense, again, terrific job. Everyone just getting their ultimates as fast as they have been, warding off every single push. The one scary moment when Laser Kittens actually had the majority on the point was dealt with very well. So I haven't seen a moment of weakness since that very first push point A, where everyone died, and since then no one has died on the defense. We've got Earthshatter catching the doorway. Three people get flattened, and Zhao 8 launches a long-range bomb, gets three kills at once. Incredible defense once again off the back of just one Earthshatter.
This is getting pretty ridiculous as well, because Nesh invested his Graviton. After they'd already hooked Alexi out of position, they got the Graviton out, it worked well, they found people, but they're taken down by the counter CC ult, the Earth Shatter from Alexi. And despite the fact they hooked him and then they slapped him, he still manages to get the Earth Shatter off, and him and Chao are playing excellently on this defense.
I've got Zapraise POV just because he's got the tactical visor. He's going to launch it in the back line, but he's got nothing but tanks to shoot at. Main walks out from behind line of sight into the tactical visor. So that's actually a huge pickup there for Zapraise, finding both supports. So big advantage here for Laser Kittens in overtime as being the operative part of this, basically. You've got Krems actually just skating around as Lucio in the high ground, trying to stay out of the fight completely. You've got Nano Boost here onto Alex for the defense to try and hang on here. Nano Boosted Kib, Roadhog trying to get some shots out, but only has four shots to work with before he's forced to reload. Whole Hog comes out from Kib, Sound Barrier as well, gives them a second wind here on the point. They've got the first tick secured, but the defense are streaming back out as quickly as they can. Graviton Surge finally comes out here from Zhao 8, and they get both kills that they're looking for there. Whole Hog again coming in, the clutch fuse, cleaning up, no problem. That combo was so effective for them over and over again, and they just looked terrific on defense. No other way to say it.
Yeah, that quad tank strategy definitely working out for them, but not only that, they looked way more coordinated. Now, it might be the switch of Cypher for Zhao, because he was definitely playing really well on the Zarya in particular when he switched over to it on the defense. But also the way that the team was pushing forward as five, pushing forward as six, sorry, and then moving backwards as six, there was only one time that they got anybody caught out of position particularly, and that was Cooler, who stayed a little too far forwards when he was on Winston. But because they've got such a large health pools as well, it's not that bad if individual players get picked off, because they can stall for such a long amount of time that they can just get back on the point if they drop a singular person. And on that last push, the ult coming out from Zapraise manages to pick up both supports, and they still can't convert. That's a massive amount of health taken out of the situation, and they're not able to deliver again. So Laser Kittens looking outclassed on this map, at least.
How many ults do you think were committed late there by Laser Kittens. 4 or 5, maybe maybe even more. I mean, we call it out the best we can when we see it, just because, you know, losing a Dragon Blade in a lost fight or a sound barrier specifically can be just incredibly crippling for your chances. Do you think Laser Kittens, was that like a pivotal part of their failure here?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you've hit on something really important for that Laser Kittens offense, was that their ult economy was pretty poor. Individual timing of when they wanted to use ultimates, as you say, they were throwing them into losing situations. Kib, Krems in particular, names that spring to mind as people who were using their ults in poor situations and then didn't have them for future fights. So they'll have to hold incredibly well here, because so far Xrock's looking like the better team.
All right, gates are open. We've got a very similar composition once again. Lots of tanks. Cooler off of the Winston onto D.Va this time around, but on the defense, seeing again some familiar roles. Nesh is not going to be starting out on a tank, though. Wingheaven is the solo Winston tank for this dive defense. Nesh is going to be playing the soldier instead. But as the fight unfolds, Wingheaven actually has to get out of town very quickly, leaping back toward his team just because he got super low health, unable to really stop them from taking the position they wanted. Nesh gets pushed off of the high ground and actually forced away by Cooler, so that little 1v1 definitely paid off well for the attacking team. They still got a high ground advantage, and on the point itself, Zapri is kind of the lone warrior here for the defense.
And it seems like Laser Kittens don't really have a good idea of who they want to go on at any particular time. They're doing a lot of damage across the board to Xrock, but they don't seem to be focusing down individual targets particularly well.
I see Zapre, yeah, I mean, when you've got Genji and Tracer, basically they're looking for whatever they can get at any time. Coordinating them can be tough if they're all the way across the map from each other and stuff like that, but Zapre finding the kills here finally gives Laser Kittens some nice foothold on the defense. Things were looking pretty scary for them at the beginning. They kind of just faded into the background, the defense, but eventually the kills piled up. Nesh did manage to stay alive despite getting knocked off by Cooler very early in the fight and eventually found that kill. So good moves there by Soldier, and Zapri will call out here for that first defense. 2.5 minutes left, and the ults will start to fly out here.
They've got the Nana Boost, but they've used it onto the D.Va, which I'm not particularly a big fan of. Maybe would have been better using it onto Alexei or possibly even Chao, but they're going to reply with a Soundbarrier and an Earth Shatter. The catch is Gray as well. That's going to be heals taken out of the situation for Laser Kittens. It's going to be difficult for them to hold on. Nesh is in a great position, though. He's able to 1v1 this D.Va who's up there contesting him and possibly get some value out of his tactical visor.
Well, I watched a valiant effort there from Wingheaven. He Primal Rage to buy him... by his team as much time as possible, and they did burn off 45 seconds or so with that push. They will finally capture A and still have a solid 5+ minutes to work with for B, but I guess slowing them down as much as possible in A is definitely going to help things out. However, now we're looking at some composition switches for the defense. Kib is going to move on over to Roadhog off of Genji. Nesh is going to move off of Soldier onto Mei, and Mei we have not seen in play just yet, but a staple here on Anubis.
The fact that they've made these switches, though, resets their ultimate counters all the way back down to zero, essentially. They've got the two support ults, but Chao's about to have his Graviton Surge. And if they compare that with any kind of damage, this could be a great initiation for the for Xrock.
As they push in, Nesh is still just standing on the point. Kib is getting multiple kills for these attackers streaming in. Cooler's kind of the only person contesting the point itself. Zhao 8 falls extremely low. Kib helps find the kill there. And the defense managed to hang on for the first push. That's actually a lot of time burned off as well. They're going to stagger Cooler like crazy here with Mei and Roadhog. They don't have to kill Baby D.Va at all, but they are actually going to just surround her. We see this so often. D.Va just really needs like a cyanide pill or something.
That would be quite a morbid thing to add to D.Va's kit, wouldn't it? Press
maybe,
F to suicide.
Maybe an eject seat or something. She just like launches off the map and then respawns.
Yeah, it's definitely a weakness of running the hero, though. If the fight goes badly, you're just going to get stalled out for so long.
So much time is gone, yeah. 20-30 seconds, but we're back now. We've got Graviton Surge plus D.Va Suit Explosion, so bigger bang combo at the ready, but lots of ults available actually on both sides. I'm going to take third person here just so we can try and catch all the action. They're approaching on the right side now. Maywall goes up and actually does block the entrance of Roadhog, so it's a little bit valuable there. Sound Barrier on the defense, but Biotic Grenade comes right in. D.Va Explosion for the bigger bang, finds only Lucio. Kib is going to catch the Nano Boost on one side, Alex on the other. They're bashing into each other right now, but Fuse's Whole Hog actually proves to be the the big difference maker finds the low health Tracer there, and actually that was the last person on the point contesting, so they've got a trickle defense here. Lucio can't make it in. 3 minutes and 48 seconds left. That is a brutal beat down there. X Rocks making it look easy against Laser Kittens here on Anubis.
They played the ult situation so well there, X-Rocks. They're running a quad tank lineup for the most part, and that means that they've got a huge amount of power in all of those ultimates. You know, you've got the CC from the gravity.
Over on the other side, again, it will be X-Rocks leading the series 1-0 with a really impressive Anubis. So now the game type has changed a little bit. Do you think the murderers that they have on Laser Kittens, the really incredible DPS players that we've seen time and time again, do you think they might actually show up a bit better here rather than the assault map?
They looked really good yesterday when they played on Oasis. They looked like they had set plans for each different stage, and Kib in particular was an absolute carrying force when he was playing Roadhog. But it's the tanks that tend to be, in my opinion, the most impactful on a lot of the stages of Oasis. And so if they're going to run with something similar like the quad tank, and Fuse has a really good game on Roadhog, and we continue to see Zhao really excel on Zarya, then I can actually see X-Rocks running away with this one.
All right, it's going to come down to those CC ultimates for sure on the side of X-Rock, still favoring four tank play. Over on the other side, they're rocking three of their own, so they know what they're up against, and they're trying to do their best to match against it. Kib's Roadhog trying to do his best against Fuses, but on the point itself, it's actually Laser Kittens forcing X-Rocks to come into them, try and take the point away. So at the beginning, as the point is open for capture, that's going to be actually the starting gun there for Zhao to rush forward. Winghaven's shield breaking pretty quickly there. Cooler actually gets put to sleep in the D.Va suit, and I'm just looking, these early fights can be so crazy. Every hook, super important. Fuse does get hooked in, but not eliminated. Cooler actually gets a nano boost incredibly quickly on his D.Va suit. He's just blasting away now. Good stuff there for X-Rocks to generate that ult so quickly. That will definitely give them advantage, and they're going to take the first point here.
Main building that one up insanely fat here. We're getting a lot of ultimates out. There's been a ton of damage. There's such high health pools on both sides and such large damage potential that the teams are generating their ultimates really quickly. And although X-Rocks got a much better beginning to this round, it looks like when the ultimates came into play, it was Laser Kittens on top.
Yeah, Laser Kittens do manage to flip it. 25% going the way of X-Rocks. Not the most amount to try to overcome there, so Laser Kittens very quickly will be able to tie that up. And no ults available now except for Zhao 8's Graviton Surge, which we've seen a time and time again. Three ults coming online for Laser Kittens, though, still favors them in the end. Sound Barrier coming out there to try to negate that Graviton Surge. Zhao 8 launched it so quickly, and Cooler did not have the D.Va suit explosion ready to go for it. Kib finds a quick kill onto Main with the hook combo, and again, Laser Kittens actually going to hang on and increase their lead to something like 45%.
It was a nice Graviton Surge from Nesh that managed to catch Fuse and Aang. They did a lot of damage to both of them. Now they're pressing really far forwards, trying to apply that pressure and make sure that they keep X-Rocks on the back foot. They want them to use the ultimates as they engage through the choke points rather than having them once they get onto the point. But lots of ults going to be up for both sides. Both teams going to have the Nano Boost available. Neither of them have the Graviton, but they both have Earth Shatter. So Reinhardt Mind Games could decide which team gets the better initiation.
I'm glad you called that out. That's always my favorite part. Take the third-person view over the Reinhardts and see who slips up. But the D.Va suit actually is going to be the engage. Kib is going to follow up with Whole Hog. Earthshatter catches only Winghaven, and they do not get the kill that they're looking for. Laser Kittens hanging on once again. 5v5 now as more ults are flying out. Fuse is going to use his Whole Hog once he sees the slight advantage on positioning that he had. But Zapray's Tac Visor actually going to get the most value there. Finishing off those low-health targets is no problem at all. Somehow X-Rocks flipped that during the fight, early on in the fight, so they squeezed out some extra percentage that Laser Kittens might be missing in the near future. But either way, Laser Kittens come out on top here, 72% now. It's still X-Rox's prerogative to try and force them off the point in basically the last fight coming up.
Despite the fact that Laser Kittens are getting the better end of most of the ultimate fights, they have so much health on the pool of X-Rocks that they have to respect the fact whenever they go aggressive. That's a nice early hook to take down Zhao. And that's going to allow Laser Kittens to go aggressive. Another great hook. Kim's going ham.
Here comes the Graviton Surge and the Nano Boost onto Nesh. Gets a ton of damage in just a short span, and that actually should finish things up here. D.Va loses the suit. Reinhardt, once that Nano Boost ends, he's going to get surrounded and taken out. And the first round, the university stage of Oasis, will go firmly to Laser Kittens. I think X-Rox did take the point only twice over the course of that, one at the very beginning and one kind of sneaky flip, but otherwise Laser Kittens had it fully in hand.
And although they were using less tanks, it was better performance from most of the tanks in terms of how they were fighting and how they were using their ultimates as well. And Zapra's damage definitely helps them out when he's playing on the Soldier 76. He can shred into it, whereas Kula, that's essentially the biggest difference between these two teams, was that Kula was on the D.Va, whereas Zapra was playing Soldier 76. And Kula didn't really get that much done. He wasn't helping out in the Shield Wars as much because the two teams were just playing so aggressively into each other. But this stage is very different. D.Va, very impactful, and the Mercy Pharah combo is something we saw extensively from Laser Kittens yesterday.
Doors are open again, and this time we have a Zenyatta in play, as well as a Pharah Mercy comp on the other side. So a little bit of variety here, mixing it up here for the jump pad level, also known as City Center here on Oasis. Nesh already getting pocketed, of course, trying to land those long-range rockets onto Soldier. That's going to be his biggest threat. Oh, nice air shot there onto Zhao 8's Tracer. Gets a great start here, and Pharah just takes that as the cue to dive right in, start dunking on everybody that he can find, and Cooler won't last long. That's going to be, again, X-Rox starting out with the... Oh, excuse me. No, it is Laser Kittens, again, flipping the point for themselves.
Yeah, they're getting a very good start to this round. They found the early pick onto the Tracer. That opens things up a lot, gives them the advantage, and they've got Kib here on the D.Va, which is really powerful on this particular stage. There's a lot of areas that she can jump around and really use the mobility of her mech to a large degree. And she can support Nesh and Grey playing the Pharah Mercy as well.
I'm going to take Zapri's POV here just because he was very effective in that first fight. Zhao 8's going to use the jump pad again as Tracer. At least he does have the ability to rewind if he doesn't like what he sees. But the rest of the team is going to follow suit now. Winston and D.Va, very interesting choices here. They're going to, of course, try to dive the same targets when they can. But Zapri manages to stay alive with a nice rewind. 40% already now for Laser Kittens. Fuse is on the point, generally alone. Pulse Bomb whiffs from Zapri as Fuse gets out of there. But actually, X-Rox finding the first kill gives him a nice opportunity to try and follow up. I'm watching Zhao 8 now, has a Pulse Bomb at the ready, may not even need to commit it here.
They've still got the res up as well from Gray, so maybe if a few of these players fall and they feel like the point is being contested, they'll be able to use that ultimate and get them back in the fight. He is going to res Windhaven, keep that alive as the self-destruct comes in. This is looking like a decent fight here from X-Rox. They've used the sound barrier and they're picking off targets one by one.
Yeah, the res came in and it wasn't like a huge momentous swing. I think he picked up one, maybe two with it. And then immediately they got the Mercy kill anyway. So X-Rox do flip it, but admirable job there getting the percentage all the way up to 74% over an incredibly long fight. That's going to favor them immensely if they happen to take the point just one more time. So watching Zhao 8 here actually falls, but does get a Pulse Bomb out that might allow his team the ability to finish things off, but Fuse as the last person standing, not going to last long as D.Va. Of course, they want to kill her quickly this time as compared to Anubis. Cooler and Fuse both go down, and Laser Kittens grab the point again, 76%, and they're going to get aggressive with it, move right toward that enemy spawn. Can't hear you. My ultimate is charging. Still with us, Sideshow? Sideshow, I can't hear you, so I'm going to keep casting. But Gray, Kib, Windhaven all up here on the high ground, just leaping around trying to find these various entry points here. It looks like our call may have disconnected. Sideshow actually disconnected. All right, no biggie deal. I'll keep solo casting here. Nanovisor onto Cooler is going to get us started here, just blasting away full force in the face of the enemy Tracer, and both supports actually go down in that fight as well. 99%. X-Rox trying to flip it back if they can. Looks like Nesh will fall. Overtime actually was triggered, but X-Rox managed to grab the point back in the end. I'm going to go ahead and take Zhao 8's POV here and try and get our buddy Sideshow back if possible. Hi. Still waiting with that Pulse Bomb. Zhao 8 trying to find some juicy targets. All right. Sideshow did not pick up, so hopefully his connection will be figured out it looks like he got a blue screen of death, so he'll be returning as quickly as he can. Nesh here on the Pharah has Barrage ready to go. There's a lot of ults actually available for Laser Kittens. They only need to win one fight here, and main has just gone down. Aang is down now as well, so no supports available for the attacking team here. Defense looks like they should be able to hang on. Laser Kittens, Nesh uncontested really in the skies all the way until he drops that lovely Barrage, and it looks like we should be able to get Mr. Sideshow back in here, so let's do that. And there is the point again. Laser Kittens. Laser Kittens have now gone up to 2-0. Sideshow, they held it firm there on City Center. Can't hear you. I see you, so I know you're there. I see your mouth moving, but third stretch here is going to be taking place on Gardens. Laser Kittens up 2-0 already. Just need to grab one more round to bring it home. Still can't hear you. I don't know what has happened. Hello. Damage amplified. Still can't hear you. So we did audio tests and all that before, but we weren't accounting for a blue screen of death to undo anything. Unfortunately, as soon as we hear Sideshow, it's going to be great, I promise you. But right now, we've got Gray and Nesh hopping over the wall very quickly, trying to find some free rockets onto the tanks coming through the midline here. Looks like Reinhardt's shield already starting to break down a little bit. Not going for that concussive shot just yet, just because D.Va, of course, can fly right back up. Does use it on Roadhog, but does not quite get the kill he's looking for. Now trying to actually have a sky duel against Cooler's Pharah. That was interesting. Nesh does come out on top there and gets a nice rocket planted right on the enemy's Pharah's face. And it looks like Laser Kittens is actually on the ropes a little bit. They still have D.Va and Pharah in play, but X-Rocks really have the ground game going for them. Alex specifically finding two kills there. But that point is still not flipped. Pharah and D.Va just lasting forever here, trying to prevent them from capping it. Finally, we got the X-Rocks capture. And maybe Sideshow is here.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, I hear you. It's a miracle. We did
incredible.
It.
Incredible. Christmas miracle. I'm not back in the game yet, though. So,
you're not back in the game. Okay.
You'll have to keep going, unfortunately.
Can I invite you? I'm trying it. Player not found. All right. Well, as soon as Sideshow's back in the game, he'll be providing us some terrific insight. But right now, Cooler is actually back here as Pharah. He has a fancy gold border as well, which means he's played a million bajillion games of Overwatch since release, but he's launching some really long-range rockets. Really don't expect those to find their targets out over the water like that, but he's going to change focus over there to Winston. Winston nearly goes down. Kid loses his D.Va suit as well, so X-Rocks starting off in a nice fashion here. If they can kill this Mercy, I think, yes, they do. It should be all in hand now for X-Rocks. Still working on Sideshow getting back in the game. If I knew what to do, if you have a suggestion to get you back in, I can try my best. But as it is, looks like Nesh is going to have his barrage ready to go. Gray does have a resurrection available, so if they do break in here, happen to grab a couple of quick kills, perhaps they can flip the point back. But as it is, X-Rock 65% and rising, and they have not let go of this point at all. It seems to be a much more cohesive defense now from X-Rock on this final stage, this garden level. But they're approaching from the high ground. Cooler all the way up in the sky, trying to stay above Nesh so he doesn't get barraged on. D.Va suit comes flying out and catches Tracer of all people. So X-Rocks already off to a 6v5 as this fight gets engaged. 84% for X-Rocks. If they can win the rest of the fight, they will be able to extend this map. Barrage ready to go, but no great angle to use it. Cooler's going to commit to his. Does get the kill on Lucio, but goes down, of course, to that enemy Tracer. Nesh still hovering around, launches the barrage. Does not have the damage amp, though. Can't get the kills he's looking for. 99% for X-Rocks, and they still have lots of bodies on the point. However, it does seem Laser Kittens does have the bulkier characters. Kib's going to lose his D.Va suit, but Winston there with the Primal Rage will keep the dream alive. Players trickling back from both sides now. Sound Barrier gets used there by Krims on the side of Laser Kittens. Can they actually flip this point? It's just breaking down continually here. Zhao takes out Kib, Fuse takes out Winghaven, and X-Rocks may have finally sealed the deal here. They just need to finish off Nesh, and as he goes down, there is the point. 2-1 now, Laser Kittens lead, but Oasis will be extended by X-Rocks.
And I am finally back, although not in the game, awaiting my invite. Please, this sounds like such a good game. I need to be able to see it. What do you think the key has been for them to be able to take the lead?
Right there, it was actually just the tank play looked a lot better. Cooler was on a Pharah rather than a D.Va this time around. Zhao 8 was playing the D.Va, so just mixing a little bit more damage, I think, was definitely nice for them. But I think Gravity may have to be the one to invite you, since he was the lobby leader. I've tried twice, and it won't let me.
Just waiting for waiting for my invite back in. It might have to be an Astroshi solo job here. Doing an excellent job of it anyway.
I've had to do it before. It's not the worst thing in the world, but I'll keep trying things here. I'll invite you to the group. Maybe they'll grab you into the game.
I am. I'm coming in.
Okay, excellent. So the doors are open now. I'm going to go ahead and quickly go over to Nesh, since he's already hovering over the point. City Center is our stage. Looks like Sideshow has started spectating, so now you can get a look at everything from that solo cast earlier. But wow, Nesh really planting the rockets in there, and the rest of his team really just cleaning up on the ground. Alex finds the Kib, D.Va suit, and Baby D.Va, though, so X-Rock's still alive on point.
They look like still playing with the Pharah Mercy here, and putting a huge amount of pressure onto Alexi.
Nesh getting the damage amp from his own Mercy. Gray really planting those rockets on the returning attackers. Main is actually going to get divided from the rest of his team. Has to use a Bionade on himself and still goes down. Zapri found a lovely Pulse Bomb in the mix as well. So even though X-Rocks do flip the point to start us off after an extended fight, it's not going to last too long. Winston going to try his best, of course, to keep milking that percentage. You've got Aang on the Lucio skating around the top of the point as long as possible as well. So that percentage definitely could get up in the 30 or 40 range long enough for the rest of the team to rejoin them on a point.
The Earth Shatter comes out from Alexi, but he's getting bopped all around the place by Winghaven. They're getting the better end of this fight, and they have been for the last, what, 20 seconds or something like that, but they still aren't able to conclusively win and flip the point over. And X-Rock's stalling it out, just building point. They're up to 40% now.
Aang, actually a superstar there as Lucio, just skated around the top of the point for so long, and he can actually just dip in and out height-wise to be able to continue contesting there. So I really like that little move that he was doing over and over, just skating around the top, dipping in to continue to contest. And of course, he's a healing ward, so as his teammates returned, he was able to get them back up to full health. But X-Rocks getting a nice foot planted basically on the point will allow them a nice opportunity to try and win this point. Great start for them. We got the high ground already being defended now from the Laser Kitten side. Nesh is gonna again have that Mercy pocket and not really contested here. There's no soldier messing with him. Anna really can't dedicate the time to try to deal with him, so Nesh is just having a field day right now. 32% for Laser Kittens and Rising.
They use the Resurrect to get Winghaven back into the fight along with Krems. They drop the sound barrier, and that gives them all of the health that they need to be able to engage and fight them in this close quarter territory at the front of the city center. And on the other side of X-Rocks, when they tried to use the sound barrier and engage, because this point is so wide and because it has such a large central cylindrical column, they could just run away essentially. Aang uses his sound barrier, but they don't have the mobility, they don't have the speed to be able to bring the fight to Laser Kittens, especially when they've got Gray and Nesh just hovering above them.
It's interesting, the verticality really, really making a huge difference on this point specifically because of that giant column in the center. All these characters, D.Vas, Winstons, Pharahs, coming into huge effect. D.Va suit's going to get launched into orbit, basically, trying to take out the Pharah who is midair, but great job. Again, Nesh gets behind line of sight with plenty of time, so the D.Va suit is wasted. Barrage catches both supports. Perfect angle there for Nesh, and that's going to be an easy cleanup. Laser Kittens may have just won the map off the back of that great ultimate.
They knock Zhao out of his mesh and then take him down. Nesh is having a huge, huge impact on this particular stage. I feel like X-Rocks need to make some changes and try and structure their composition about making sure that he's taken out in the fight. Maybe run a Pharah of their own so that Nesh can't just focus on taking everybody out of the fight of X-Rocks, because he's raining rockets down with impunity. Look at that, into the back of Cooler and now into Alexi, and there's nobody dealing with him at all.
It's really pretty much unforgivable. Like last point when you weren't in here, Cooler was on Pharah. They had their, you know, they had their air duels, so at least Nesh was occupied, but I've been on Nesh like 80% of this round because he hasn't died. His streak has to be like 20 plus. We're gonna see the card at the end. But Nesh had the game, you know, he had the round of his life there because he was just uncontested. And it's going to be Laser Kittens taking the map in the end. We'll get a nice look at play of the match honors here. Nesh as Zarya, Graviton Surge most likely going to be taking those honors. But Laser Kittens fight back, and they really just punch Xrox in the mouth and say, hey, Anubis was a fluke. You still got to deal with us here.
I'm analyzing from a point of ignorance here because I missed out a couple of the rounds, but is it fair to say then that Xrox tried this Pharah v Pharah split in attention and it didn't work for them, and possibly is that why they didn't try it when it went over to City Center?
I guess what I can kind of take away from it is Cooler didn't have a pocket mercy when he was on the Pharah on the garden level. There is a lot of verticality on that one as well and a lot of it potential for environmental kills. But Cooler didn't have a mercy. So I'm really wondering if the lack of mercy player is what kept them on the tanks instead. It was kind of interesting. Let's figure out what our next map is going to be. The series is now tied 1-1. So we're going to go the distance here in this BO3. But yeah, I think... honestly, I'm not sure why Cooler went back to Winston there. It seemed like their strategy was ignore the Pharah, which also means ignoring the Mercy in that case, if Mercy's always with Pharah, and it just didn't pan out. They didn't find the kills on the ground that they were looking for. They needed to really, if they're going to ignore the Pharah and Mercy, they needed to win that outright, and they just couldn't get it done. The ult combos were not there. The amazing stuff that we saw out of Xrox on Anubis was not really replicated on Oasis at any point that I could see, so... it looked like always entertaining player at least, and of course just an incredibly solid tank. That's why he's still here competing today. But Cooler has Sombra locked in on the defense. They have enough time to go back and change if he wanted to, if they're going to try this fake out business, but it looks like they're going to stick with it. So I'm very anxious to see what Cooler can do.
Yeah, we'll see what composition they end up running with. Also, The fact that they went for the Torbjorn, they tried this yesterday as well, I seem to remember, and it got completely destroyed. Aang on Torbjorn got just melted within the first couple of seconds. So they'll definitely be aiming to have that work slightly better for them this time on the defense of Eichenwald.
Torb's turret is inside the right side health room. Cooler probably going to be running protection on it since he did hack that health pack already. He's already in their backline looking for someone to hack, most likely a tank or a healer. So he's going to jump right onto Gray and actually gets the kill immediately. So Cooler already providing huge value and had enough time left on his translocator to get back and hack another health pack. So perfectly executed there by Cooler to get us started.
And they've got this really dive composition from Laser Kittens. Oh, Gray's actually gone back and switched to the Ana as well, so wasn't feeling Zenyatta. Maybe because Cooler's threatening the dive onto him whenever he comes in, you know, he can just sneak in behind. And Cooler's building up that ult really quickly as well.
I'm watching Zapre's Tracer. They know exactly where that Torb turret is, so they're going to move around the right side with the Winston bubble to try and just ignore it and force him to replace it. But they probably will be marching toward the point. They just need to work on these tanks here. Cypher actually on the Zarya falls very low, but Nain picks him back up. Aang falls to Nesh's attacking Pharah. And again, if Pharah is uncontested, we know what Laser Kittens can do already with an uncontested Pharah, and they're doing a great job already on the point. EMP comes out, though. This could be a tide changer here.
That's a really important EMP, but they need to start getting onto people that it's effective, and they didn't have any follow-up for it, and so Laser Kitten's still going to be able to take it. And they've got the old sub to be able to contest this for a little further. Alexi gets a nano boost onto him, but that's the only one that's going to be available, and Nesh with the barrage. Survive there? How on earth did Cooler survive?
Can't wait for Chat's reaction on that one, because he wasn't there. He translocated. He didn't even hit the Torb turret that was like an inch under the door there, but I guess if he's going to switch anyway, whatever, use the barrage. That was pretty ridiculous looking, but hey, you're going to switch anyway. So Nesh is over to the soldier now. Pharah did a terrific job on point A again, just freely raining rockets down. Didn't even have a mercy to work with that time, so no excuse there from Xrox to try and deal with it. We've got Kibbs Dragonblade ready to go. He's going to hop right up that wall, had both supports in his sights. All he has to do is hit Q and get two kills, but he's not doing it. I guess they feel confident that they're going to get these kills. Finally, Dragonblade does come out. Nano boost comes onto him, but he gets Earth Shattered and pinned. So Xrox, defense holding here potentially. Lots of tanks and Ana still at the cart.
Yeah, they're really running with this tank-heavy lineup. The triple tank soldier working well for them so far. But they haven't just been able to defend the cart. I mean, it worked well for them, but the respawns are coming in much quicker than they're killing them at the moment. And this Sound Bear is going to allow Kib and Winghaven to really try and engage and pick up some targets.
Zapre gets put to sleep, actually did get in the castle itself to try and deal with Anna, but just got knocked on his butt instead. The payload has not really moved at all. Cooler's got high ground here as Soldier, so at least he tried to react to a fair that isn't there anymore. Cooler, of course, is just valuable on the high ground no matter what. Lots of squishies to aim at as well, since the only tank here is Winghaven, and he's nowhere to be seen at the moment.
Alexi takes a biotic grenade, is going to get taken out. Despite the fact they've got a lot of ults available for X-Rocks, they weren't really ever in a position to use them. So Laser Kittens continue to push this payload. It's going to be all the way up onto the bridge before anybody from X-Rocks is going to be able to contest. But as I said, a lot of ultimates here for a good team wipe whenever they actually do attempt to block this objective.
Watching Zapre here, getting close to a pulse bomb. Nesh also has tactical visor. He's going to launch it from the high ground. Actually, oh, he's got incredibly low health targets, but spent a lot of time on that Winston bubble. I'm not sure what happened there. He had a free Lucio kill if he had just seen it, I think. But either way, X-Rocks do grab the cart back. Nesh not effective enough on his own with the rest of where his team was positioned. It really didn't work out. So X-Rocks, congrats to them, holding once again 2.5 minutes to go. Lots of ults available here. Earthshatter most likely going to come into big play on this next push. Kib with the Dragonblade again has an opportunity, but we're at that awkward position of the second stretch where there's not a clean attacking angle anywhere.
Alexi uses the Earthshatter and pings Winhaven, but he's still going to survive. This is going to be a nano-boosted a tactical visor as Cooler just runs around trying to find anybody to use it on, actually, but only took Gray out there. The rest of Laser Kittens going to be able to duke and dodge, completely avoid him. And they've still got that Nanoblade up. They wisely realized that they shouldn't invest ultimates into that fight. It was a lost fight going into it. X-Rocks use, what was that, 3, 4? And now they're in a position to push Laser Kittens.
X-Rocks, yeah, they're working with essentially nothing here, so they're looking for instant kills from the Hog Hook. Lots of defensive play, perhaps, but Fuse is actually going to get jumped on immediately by Kib. Kib still has the Dragonblade ready to go. Finds that kill and the dash reset onto Cooler. Great stuff from Kib, but Alex is getting it done on the ground. 3 limbs for him. There's the Dragonblade. Dash reset finds both supports, but the two tanks stand tall. Alex and Cypher end up as the last two remaining survivors after that huge bloodbath. Nano was not used there, just the Dragonblade, so they at least still have some tools to work with. Nano Winghaven, for example, could be quite good here. So I'm going to go ahead and take his POV, but we've got the cart approaching the point. Finally, X-Rocks do return to the cart, and they almost have an Earthshatter to work with, so hopefully Alex can stay alive long enough to make use of that.
Bit of a wasted Nano Boost, in my opinion, from Kib. But now X-Rocks are going to reply with a nano-boosted Barry and Queen Winston, who flies around, knocking Cypher into the pit. He's onto both of their supports, or a support and a soldier in the backline, destroys both of them, actually. A huge play from Winghaven, and he's able to take it forwards. Perhaps even better than using it with the nanoblade, given what he got out of that one.
Yeah, they gave it to Winghaven's Primal Rage and the damage, and I'm not sure if any of those were environmental kills. I'm pretty sure he just smacked him in the face along with the rest of his team there. 2 minutes left for the final stretch. Winghaven still the solo tank on the defense. Doesn't look like they're making any switches. I didn't catch Alex's last Earthshatter, but it had to be used in that cleanup prior to that fight. Now inside the castle itself, the final destination, you've got X-Rocks firmly on the cart. Lots of ults, maybe not lots of ults, but some really effective ones here to try and work with. Fuse's Whole Hogs have been very, very good so far. Nesh is going to launch the tactical visor to start the fight off.
Everyone hiding behind Alexi's shield, but in comes Dragonblade as well, and that's going to take him straight through it. Cuts down Fuse in the back line, who was trying to use his Whole Hog, and that's going to be Laserkin storming forwards and seeing if they can lock people off at the spawn, I think. Oh, for the moment, they're just stacking the car, but if they try and get forward, there might be some respawning targets they can pick off.
I'm watching Nesh actually already up on the high ground. I don't know if anyone caught a vision of him or not. Cypher actually just ran right past him as Tracer, so Nesh is going to be back in his favorite spot. Uncontested soldiers today, man. It's like a repeating story, but Alex is going to fall in the mayhem here. That gives a nice wide open door for Winghaven and the rest of Laser Kittens. But the nano cooler boost there actually did not get the value it was looking for. A couple of ults committed without much to gain for it. Defense looking a little bit haphazard here, but offense also losing some members means that they're not really in a spot where they can try to finish the map right now. 30 seconds to go means they will regroup and have one last attempt.
What they're going to have is a tactical visor and a Dragon Blade. Potentially going to be able to sync both of those up with the Transcendence from Grey, depending on their rates of building and how quickly they want to push. And that'll keep both of the DPS players alive, meaning that they can't particularly focus them down. And it's going to be on Alexi to hit a fat Earth Shatter to try and block this attack from coming in.
All right, last fight means third person as everyone's going to use everything. Winghaven and Alex up in the front, show eating each other down. Kib gets a Dragon Blade out with that Sound Barrier benefit. Pulse Bomb goes out. Cypher finds a kill, but it's all Laser Kittens cruising through here. All the ults that they committed there, Dragon Blade, Tac Visor, and Sound Barrier piling up against the odds there. Defense will not be able to make it back to the cart at all, so overtime is going to be triggered, but they will capture the cart in the end. Good stuff there from Laser Kittens to close it out. With only 2 minutes in that last stretch, can be difficult.
Heart in my mouth a little bit as Cypher gets a pulse, a really nice dodging pulse bomb in onto Grey and takes him down before he's got the opportunity to use his Transcendence, but it didn't matter anyway because Krems had the Sound Barrier that kept both of their DPS players alive, and they found all of the kills that they needed. Alexi couldn't quite hit the Earth Shatter he needed to take the DPS targets out. You know, couldn't find Kib when he uses his Nano Blade, isn't able to take down Nesh, and they crumble and fall, unfortunately, for X-Rox fans. But if you're a Laserkins fan, they're looking way better on Eichenwald than they did yesterday.
It's true. Finishing with any amount of time is pretty nice. Yesterday, I think I was talking to Alicus after the games because I didn't get to see everything. I had only saw the Oasis match. He said, that's okay. One of the maps was a prank. I think it was King's Road. Maybe, was it? No, I guess King's Road beat NIP on...
Yeah, they only lost on Eichenwald.
Okay, so Eichenwald was the joke, he said. Alicus said don't bother watching that one. But here we are on Eichenwald again. Laser Kittens in a position to try and take this series if they can put up a good defense. However, X-Rox, after taking Anubis in the fashion that they did, I still like their odds here. Cypher is not Zhao 8. That's going to play out different, of course, just anytime you use a sub versus a main roster player. So we'll see if Cypher can be the difference maker here as Zarya. No flanking characters really in play, not even any D.Va or Winston, so kind of interesting. They're going to try and brute force it through the choke instead.
And on the defense, they have the Torbjorn set up from their usual Lucio player, Krems, so they've got the single support set up. It doesn't look like X-Rox are going to go for that diving composition, so there's no opportunity to really get in straight onto Grey and take him out of the fight and remove all the heals for this solo support comp that they're going to be meeting on the defense. But they need a plan to take down the Torbjorn turret at the very least.
Doors are open now. Cooler's actually going to take a far left approach just in case he's stared down at the front door, but ends up not making a difference at all. We'll see the first clash here. Roadhogs trying to take out each other's Reinhardt shields. As you do, Firestrike actually does hit like three or four people there. Winghaven gets a lot of ult charge right away. Torp turret goes down. Cooler needs a little bit of help, but Fuse finds the first kill on Zapri. That's going to be a great invitation to march onto the point. That is where the Torp turret is. Zarya bubbles, keeping everyone healthy there. And a nade to start the fight off also proved to be valuable. Kib finds the enemy Anna, though, and the fight is starting to break down a little bit.
The Torps have been completely ineffective whenever we've seen them on defense so far in this tournament. Kib lands a big hook. It's been a battle of the Roadhogs to see what initiation picks they can get. Despite picking Zapri really early on, they're not going to be able to overcome the rest of Laser Kittens, who rallied themselves in that hunting lodge and came out looking for some antlers to put on the walls.
Yeah, they may have found some if Winghaven was using that specific skin. Alexi, I guess. But there's that one Balgruuf or something like that skin that has some antlers on it. Zapri here as Tracer actually has Torb armor, actually is piling up now, so this is kind of a tipping point that the defense are looking for. Kib finds the first kill on Cypher, even when there's a visor active. Oh, excuse me, it was a defensive visor, so yeah, that makes sense. They're going to get all the kills there. Cooler did not commit his. He's just now coming out of the gate here with the rest of his support, so they're going to regroup, try and figure out their attack angle. Alex does have Earthshatter, but so does Winghaven, so things are going to get more and more difficult as time goes on if that Torb armor starts to pile up and those ults come online.
Absolutely, and the ult that's online now is Krem's Molten Core, and that's just such a stalling ultimate. You know, he can put that down at any point, gets a huge turret up, he has loads of armor.
Huge
Earthshatter!
The visor right after from Cooler, but he gets put to sleep. There's Molten Core coming out from Krems, just blasting away at the Nano Cypher Zarya on the point. Whole Hog comes out from Fuse. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off there, but that was, I just got the perfect angle on that Earthshatter plus visor, and that is going to be enough to seal up point A, I'm assuming. No one's going to be able to return to the point quick enough. And
they used so many ultimates to try and defend that as well, Joshy. They used the whole hog, they used the molten core as well, and the Earth Shatter was so impactful. They had so many people on the floor, and they were able to use ults of their own, of course, that X-Rox take that with astounding speed.
Yeah, just over a minute, I believe, maybe a minute and a half to get the job done there after getting deflected away the first time. The second push actually ended up not being too big of an issue. The Torb armor didn't make the huge difference we were looking for. Graviton Surge came out there. I'm not really sure what happened. I didn't actually see the Graviton Surge, and Cypher ended up dying in the process, but kind of an interesting fight there. Offense trying to rally now as Alex goes down. They will need to wait a little bit. It's going to be Laser Kittens hanging onto the cart, but 3.5 minutes, still a lot of time to work with. You don't want to just stand on the cart where these spawns are situated, so they're going to go back up onto the high ground and try and get some picks before X-Rox can bring the fight to them.
It was their defense that flopped yesterday, but it looks like Laser Kittens are much more coordinated with what they want to do. Pib finding a hook and almost gets the first pick, but there's an Earth Shatter out as well. They've lost so much health for that, though, and Nesh with his tactical visor doesn't even need the Nanoboost to be able to shred through players.
Nanoboost was used on Cooler, who did not get a lot of damage out with it, but there were enough low-health targets in the area that he decides to use the tactical visor to free that cart anyway, and does find the kills he's looking for. So now the high ground is basically forfeit. Anna's the only defensive player up there. If Soldier actually decides to go pick a fight with her, Gray probably won't last too long, but now Nesh is back into play. The cart has moved under the choke point, so kind of an interesting battle area again for the attackers. If they don't win this fight, it can be very difficult to get back to the cart. Nesh is going to actually get a nano boost, but no tac visor available. Sound barrier comes out as well for the defending team. Gray goes flying off the map. Crazy things actually happening here. But X-Rox looking very strong on the cart.
Yeah, they established their position on the cart and they weren't worried at all about Nesh's nano boost. As you said, no attack visor ready, and Alexei just held up his shield, and that's all of the damage mitigated and all completely taken out of the situation. And Kib's gonna get pressured down by a super high energy Cypher, who's running forward with a Graviton as well. Possibly going to try and catch spawners and stagger them even further?
I hope not. That's kind of a risky play, right? If the whole rest of your team isn't really there with you, so he's gonna do the right thing, I think, and just back out. They have three ults. I don't know if they've been keeping track of their enemies, but they're at a huge advantage. Soundbear and Grav both come out, and it's an easy slaughter there. Biotic Grenade goes right into the Graviton. Cypher just lights him up. He's at 90 energy right now, and that cart is continuing to just flow through this castle. It's the final stretch here, going into third person to see what this trickle defense can do. Zapper gets shut down on the way back to the cart. Earthshatter slaps them all in the face as they try to return, and the tac visor from Cooler will put the nail in the coffin. 2 minutes 54 seconds left as they complete the map. I believe this will go to extra rounds, but is it correct that because of the overtime finish, they're not going to be able to defend or able to attack, that is?
Yeah, they won't get an opportunity. It's all on this first point defense. And the ultimate coordination that we've seen so far from X-Rox has been brilliant. When they have these ultimates up, particularly the tank ultimates, their coordination to make sure they execute and get a lot of value out of each one has been overwhelming so far for Laser Kitten's defense.
Really good stuff there from X-Rox. Their second stretch could not really have gone better. I think there were a couple of awkward spots where if they had lost the fight, they would have been in trouble. But that one on the bridge, it just broke down so quickly for Laser Kittens. They just didn't have the time to set up properly. I think Nesh and Gray specifically were on the high ground as the cart was moving under them. The rest of their team couldn't join them. So it was just two or three smaller fights breaking out, and X-Rox came out on top of all of them just because they had a very cart-centric mindset, I would say, trying to stay very close to each other. Again, I used that word nuclear in the first map, or in the first series, and I think that described them very well again here, where they just kind of all stayed together. They just dealt with incoming threats rather than going to pick fights, and it worked out. That third stretch, again, just because they had the momentum and they had the ultimates ready to go, there was nothing Laser Kittens could really do inside the castle. And now we're in our final attempt here for X-Rox trying to win the series.
X-Rox are still rolling out with this lineup that gives them a ton of finishing power, and that's what they need. They need the Graviton, the Earth Shatter, into the Tactical Visor, and also the Whole Hog. If they get any of these online and are able to coordinate them, it could be all said and done here for Laser Kittens. It's going to be really difficult for them to defend.
Laser Kittens actually got backed out away from the point, and Cooler was already back there to start shooting at them. So X-Rox already have their foot planted. Kib and Zapri finding kills, though, gives them some new life. Nesh Helix Rocket taking out Alex actually means all six players from Laser Kittens have returned, so a nice cleanup there actually gives them new life. There was one tick secured. That easily could have been game over, so well played there by Laser Kittens to hang in and give themselves another chance.
The fact that Zapri is on Tracer rather than Zarya, which is the main difference between these two compositions, means that...
Looks like you're frozen again, Sideshow. I hope you're not actually blue screening again. But as the kills are piling up now, Zapri finds one for the defense. Roadhog's getting very low there in the front line as well. Hey, Zapri's actually going to get hooked in, but Fuse goes down instead. So defense still managing to hang on. There's a lot of ults piling up again. Five ults here for the defense. We're going to try and get Sideshow back as quickly as we can here. Apologies, folks. Looks like the call did just drop. We'll see if he does actually leave the game or not. But go ahead and take Cooler's POV here. He's got the TAC visor ready to go. Sideshow has left the game officially. All right, so we're back to the solo cast. Apologies, folks. He will be back, I'm sure, as soon as possible. At the moment, though, we are going to see Cooler not commit the TAC visor. Kind of interesting. But four ults come flying up for the defense. 55 seconds left to go. It means they're putting all their eggs in one basket here. They have to win this last fight. But Cooler, as he's got the tactical visor ready, main has nano boost ready, this could be a very aggressive push and could actually win the game. If it goes to a draw, I'll have to be corrected on this if I'm mistaken, but I believe it's a best of one on a control map randomly chosen by the admins. So X-Rox really want to get this wrapped up here. They did not have the best look on Oasis earlier, so here comes the TAC visor. Nano boost is there. He's right in the enemy face of the soldier, but Soundbanger keeps him alive. Cooler falls to 1 HP and goes down. Nesh survives the nano visor in the face. Earthshatter comes out on the low ground. Alex, not sure what he caught with it, but the bulk of his team is still standing. The fight is breaking down again with some low health DPS players. Zapri gets hooked 2.0'd. It looked like he got caught but did not get reeled in, and wow, Laser Kittens in overtime managed to deflect another push from X-Rox, and that is going to be a draw. 3-3 draw despite the incredible difference in time finish in the first round. So again, will be corrected if I'm mistaken, but I believe that the overtime rules state that we are going to BO1 overtime map, control map. Play of the match. All right, I'm trying to get Sideshow back in here as Zapri gets play of the match honors with his Tracer. Take a look at these cards. 26 objective kills and 51 elims for Zapri. Excellent stuff there. Again, the series score is one win, one loss, one draw apiece. It looks like I've got Sideshow back.
Oh my god.
But no camera just yet. So we are back on the call. We're going to go back to lobby and get this tiebreaker underway. Very crazy stuff there. There's Mr. Sideshow. We'll go back to our cams now. Hello, everybody. Sideshow, what is going on with your computer, buddy? Control map first to 3 points, he says. Oh, actually, you're muted again.
This is... Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. This is more crashes than I've ever experienced in my life with this PC. I don't know what it is. It's just decided it doesn't want to, I don't know, participate today. I'm going to have to dial back my overclock or something because it's... I haven't changed it recently, but it's suddenly, like, running Skype and Overwatch is apparently too much for it. Maybe it's too warm in my room, you know? I'm too much of a hot personality when I'm on stream and it's warming up my PSU or something.
Okay, so... Hopefully your computer can stay cool during this fire overtime match that we're about to watch. It was a draw again, so we have to determine a winner for head-to-head and stuff like that, so we can't just leave it. I cannot believe Laser Kittens actually full-held A in those extra rounds, but we're doing a Lijiang Tower full map here is the tiebreaker. So we're going to a game 4, Sideshow.
That's pretty crazy, actually. The composition that they were running, I thought it was almost a given that they would be able to convert. They had so I like the fact that you get a full map out of it. I feel like the Apex tiebreakers, where they just play like a single best of one, is, you have so much variance in it, right? Because you have a variable map, and then you have the stage. You don't know which stage you're going to be on, and then you don't know which composition you're going to meet immediately. So, you know, I kind of like the fact that they're allowing them to get a feel for each other before they just kick one team into the dirt.
But they already played three full maps, man. It's so exhausting to play at your
you wanna see
for that long.
Don't you want to see more incredible action between these two teams, though? They're so close between the two of them.
That's what's been
fantastically strange to me as well, is that Laser Kittens performed so well yesterday to knock out Nip, but now they're really struggling against Tornado Rocks, or the X Rocks.
I mean, I want to see these two teams play tons of games against each other at their full endurance, you know, their full capacity. This is game four you know, hour and a half in, basically, to the series. So, you know, that's some wear and tear on your psyche and your wrists and your adrenaline and your hydration. But Kib, just getting right in there with the help of Krems, takes out Fuse. Laser Kittens already off to a strong start.
Laser Kittens going with this triple DPS dive strategy, and they need to pick out individual targets, and they picked off Fuse immediately, but now all of the health pool and that coordinated focus calling really going the way of X-Rocks instead. Getting the better end of that one by a long margin.
Looks like the chat just saw the Nanovisor versus regular soldier fight. Everyone pogchamping there for Nesh, poor Cooler getting shut down. But yeah, here on Lijiang Tower, it is going to be X-Rocks grabbing the point first. The first kill went their way, but the actual breakdown was kind of interesting. Kib got forced off the point, super low health. Alex actually found him with a hammer swing to the face, so once that DPS got removed, it was almost like dominoes falling, and X-Rocks came out on top. They're happy to have it, because Cooler's almost at a Nanovisor combo ready to go.
And Alexi may have the Earth Shatter ready to add to the whole mesh as well. It's going to be Winghaven hooked in immediately, so there's a huge amount of shield potential and just health in general taken out of the fight. The Earth Shatter takes down three, and Cooler picks up everybody. A 4K for his Nanovisor, and that's going to be Laser Kitten sent back to the drawing board.
That's a hell of an ult combo, I would say. Earth Shatter just lays them all down. Cooler was right there at the perfect spot to just destroy them all with that tactical visor. So X-Rocks, already a very different look than what we saw on Oasis. Keep in mind, that control map had Zhao 8 playing as various tanks, whereas this time we have Cypher in as Zarya. So it is actually a different team than the last control map they played against each other. We've got Kib diving in here with Soundbarrier and Dragonblade out, looking for some quick kills. Cooler, that big DPS threat, gets removed. Cypher goes down, but not until after launching the Graviton Surge. Is the Graviton enough? Doesn't look like it. Fuse launches the Whole Hog into it, but Kib had a terrific play during this entire fight. Lots of kills for Genji. The deflect onto the Whole Hog at the end, saving his teammates and saving the point. Very admirable stuff there. 80% now before X-Rocks managed to let the point slip. Laser Kittens fighting right back.
And whenever I'm watching Laser Kittens in this situation with the triple DPS, they don't look as coordinated as teams like United when they're running the same kind of thing. Unless Gray hits a really nice biotic grenade onto Fuse or Alexi, the only target they can really go for is Cooler, or I guess Cypher to a lesser extent, and they haven't been picking them off early in the fight. It's been very brawly between these two teams, and in general, that so far has gone the way of X-Rocks.
Yeah, they seem to be quite comfortable with the sumo wrestling style of Overwatch, where they're basically just like, come at me, bro, and they try to outlast the enemy team. Of course, their ult coordination has been phenomenal all series long as well.
You see a lot of sumo wrestlers saying, come at me, bro.
Totally.
It's in my day-to-day life. Sumo wrestling community.
I'll just be walking down the street and sumo wrestlers will be saying that shit to me. But Kib is here with the Nano Blade, slicing and dicing. He actually goes down to the Tac Visor from Cooler, again getting amazing value there and actually retreating long enough to keep himself alive. Soundbarrier comes out here for the attacking team, though. Laser Kittens have an opportunity in overtime as it's ticking down. If they can just find the kill, Cooler gets a 20 health again. He's always being focused but never finished off, and Cooler still alive, helps take out Winghaven. X-Rocks looking very, very good here to try and take this first point.
As 99% into overtime, only Kib left alive, and he's just sat up there with the deflect. It's inevitable, his fall, and the fall of Laser Kittens in this first round. X-Rocks playing this triple tank fantastically, really. And Alexi's getting the better end of the battle with Winghaven whenever it's I guess it's kind of unfair as well when Winghaven's playing Winston, this particular composition, but in general he's been playing a pretty good tank.
yeah, Winghaven can't complain about what we've seen out of him for sure. I think Alex on the other side, haven't been spectating him as much, but he's hit some really money Earth Shatters. It seems like whenever we're spectating a flanker or something like that, Alex just shows up in the kill feed a lot, doing his job on the cart whenever they're on payload maps. So great tank play actually out of both sides. Really, the DPS players have been the difference makers, Cooler specifically in that first round, just getting terrific tactical visors for his team, allowed them to take that first round on Market. Now we're here onto the Garden stage. Looks like comps are going to change just a little bit. Nesh is going to be back onto Pharaoh with no Mercy in tow. He's going to go for the boop. Does he get anybody? No. D.Va and Lucio both managed to save themselves, no problem.
But this change has also put Gray over onto Zen, and he's immediately taken out by Cypher's aggressive Zarya. That's got to cue some aggression from the rest of Laser Kittens. Otherwise, that's so much heals taken out of the situation that they don't have the lasting ability anymore. So they do end up going aggressive, and they get all the picks they need to be able to flip this for the first time in Laser Kittens' favor.
All these tanks mean all these direct rockets from Nesh. He is uncontested. We're back in the Oasis problem. You need some hit scan. Nesh is not terrible enough for you to ignore. He's actually hitting lots of direct hits just because you have so many tanks. Like, it's hard for him to miss when you're all bundled up like that. So Cooler is actually going to swap onto the Pharah, and this is the one round that they won of Oasis did feature Cooler on Pharah to at least challenge Nesh from time to time. But here we go, trying to push over the bridge side. Who is that actually jumping in there? Alex very quickly jumps in, but falls to under 100 HP. Discord Orb means that he will not last long. Cypher does find a kill, though. Genji actually getting in the mix, helping things out quite a bit here. So the DPS switches actually already showing a lot of value here. They're going to flip that point.
Nesh had a really nice air shot onto Cooler to take him out of the fight, but then went a little too aggressive with his barrage. As you often see, you know, you're a bit of a sitting duck if you just launch your barrage in the middle of everybody. So although he traded for quite a bit of damage, wasn't able to get the kills at the end of the fight. And in general, this strategy, as you were saying, with the swap of the DPS heroes, is working well for Xrox. They've moved away from the tanks, back to a 2-2-2, but one that definitely Fuse can still have an impact in.
You mentioned that yesterday's game, Cypher was very pivotal on the Genji, and here we're seeing that. I've actually just been spectating him, and he's doing exactly what Genjis are supposed to do, just, you know, waiting patiently, using his defensive abilities to keep him out of trouble, while simultaneously pouring a bunch of damage into whoever is picking on his supports. And Cooler, with that excellent range character, Pharah, also able to stay safe in the back lines there. This is a tough nut to crack, basically. Cypher will have Dragonblade available here, might not even need it. There he does pull it out, goes for Gray. Krems also goes down, and Xrox should hang on with those three burst kills that they just got.
That's insane as well, because Fuse used his whole hog and knocked Gray, who was using his Transcendence, off into the pit. So Gray's Transcendence completely removed from that situation. That meant that Kib wasn't able to do what he wanted with his particular Dragonblade, and the Dragonblade v. Dragonblade battle skewed very heavily there in favor of Cypher. And he comes out on top, and they again hold on to the point. 70% for them now. They've gone into the lead and more.
We've got Nesh's POV just because he's got the barrage. They fly at each other's faces, the Pharahs. That's always actually a guaranteed way to plant a rocket on somebody, is just fling yourself at them. But barrage ready to go. Sound barrier's out. This would have been his best opportunity to use it. Unfortunately, he didn't have any targets at the moment. Might be able to hit this air shot on Cooler, but as Cooler runs out of gas, it's an easy pickup for Nesh. 89% for Xrox means they're in one-and-done territory. If they do end up getting wiped here, at least they know that they can commit some ults and try to win the round anyway. Nesh doing a pretty great job there as Pharah. Not too much danger for him after taking out Cooler. They're going to regroup, though. Barrage at the ready, and Cypher pretty close to another Dragonblade.
Gray has moved over to Ana here as well, so he's moved off the Zen onto the Yana. That's going to give them an Ana boost, but he's miles behind Main, who's been building it up for a long time now, so Cypher's just about to have his Dragonblade up. It doesn't look like they're getting the better end of this particular fight, although they have managed to flip it, and they're into overtime. They just played the point. They've got the objective power.
Oh no, Cooler planted a rocket on himself. I was spectating him. There was no one nearby. He killed himself. That's all there is to it. And now Laser Kittens taking the point again, 57% and rising. They're actually giving themselves a chance, and Nesh still has his barrage to work with. Cooler does as well, so Pharah's going to be very important in this next fight. Cypher has his Dragonblade ready to go, and he really impressed with it earlier, so I'm going to go ahead and take his POV. Nano Boost also at the ready. He catches it. Can't get the slice on Nesh that he's looking for. Dives back toward his own backline to help out his healers, but Zapier's already done the damage against Fuse and Main. Cooler finally goes down. Cypher, no life left. And the point itself was contested, but not enough. Nesh, actually, as Pharah again, staying pretty much full health during that battle, did not even need to use Barrage. Now they're in a great position to take the round.
Really nicely split apart by Laser Kittens. Winghaven dived forwards, some of the rest of his DPS players moved backwards, so that Cypher was stuck in this awkward middle territory where he didn't quite know who to go for, and by the time he'd selected a target, it was almost too late as Nanoblade had run out.
Oh, Barrage is a perfect spot for Nesh! Wow, three kills right off the bat. That's like a one fight already. Kib with the dash resets just finishing the job. But Primal Rage Winston unable to do anything by himself. That Barrage was so on the money. Perfect timing there. Was able to stay hidden and jumped on them in the one exposed area on that side of the map. So feels bad for X-Rox starting out so strong there and unable to complete the point. But this map might even go the distance. We might see a win, a loss, a draw, and a full five rounds on the tiebreaker here.
Well, these two teams almost completely inseparable, but they will be separated somehow. This map will separate them. And on that final, on that previous stage, sorry, that we just saw on Guarded, X-Rox had all the opportunities in the world to be able to get back into that one and flip it over from the 99% overtime that they had already gotten. They kind of outplayed themselves. I think they overthought a lot of the opportunities they had rather than just barreling in, and Nesh caught them with some huge plays. They dodged the Nanoblade in a couple of situations, so now they're in the unfortunate situation of being 1-1.
I'm gonna go ahead and start with Kib's point of view just to see if any hook combos end up making a huge difference in this opening fight. He does get the hook, but not the damage there onto the enemy Reinhardt, but Winghaven does go down first. Cooler also gonna fall, so 5v5 to start off. Another hook does not find the kill on Zarya. Unfortunately, his team's not quick enough on the draw to react to those. Point is open now, so everyone's gonna start to boogie their way there. Aang goes down, so X-Rox is at a big disadvantage. Lots of players here for Laser Kittens able to pile onto Fuse and take him out means that Laser Kittens should grab the point first.
Both teams here playing a triple tank composition, but Cooler on the Pharah while Zafiri plays Tracer, and for the moment looks like Zafiri's getting the far better end of it. Because he's playing into so many tanks, he's just able to charge up that Pulse Bomb incredibly quickly, get a load of damage out, Earth Shatter and a Pulse Bomb out here. Things looking fairly equal between both teams, but does look like X-Rox is getting the better end of this fight as he goes forward, and the Cooler's completely uncontested.
I got Zapri sleeping on the job here. Fuse just walks up to him and plants a shot in his face to make sure that kill goes through. Kib also just going to leap off the side and rejoin his team. So X-Rox do battle back. Did they actually even use any ults? Zapri may have used a Pulse Bomb, and he's over to Soldier now already, but pretty good point grab there for X-Rox to come back in.
They're going to have ults online for both of these teams. The Nano Boost available for them both. And there is going to be a Graviton, but Nesh goes down, and that gives a huge advantage over to Cypher.
Fire at will. Graviton surges there. Cooler getting the rockets in. Barrage ready to go. 63 and 70 credit for Cooler. Will obviously just win the fight. Two ults should. And Fuse actually committed his whole hog as well. So that's actually all the ults burned off the side of X-Rox. Not their most fantastic use of the ults yet, but still gets the job done. Winghaven does have Earthshatter ready to go with Nesh's Graviton Surge, so heavily favored again, ults-wise. Will be Laser Kittens trying to retake the point. Graviton comes out first, but the counter Earthshatter actually catches one or two folks, Zapray's Soldier specifically being a big pickup there. That Earthshatter hit nothing, though, unfortunately for Winghaven. I had managed to catch that one in its full glory. But the Laser Kittens guys still do have six members. They're going to start marching here while Alex is still coming back from spawn.
And they've got the sound barrier to be able to go in. They need to deal with Cooler in the air, who takes out Zapri immediately. So that is essentially his hardest counter taken out already. And the sound barrier wasn't able to catch him. So drop from that situation, and now they're fighting 5v6 and a hook from Fuse.
Watching Cooler just raining rockets down onto these tanks, no one able to really address him. Barrage comes out, and Winghaven's shield gets quite low. Kib goes down, but X-Rox still not in full control of this fight by any means as it starts to break down all over the map. Aang of the Lucio is actually still on the point. It's a good thing they found that kill on Winghaven and Nesh essentially at the same time, because that should lock up the round. Those are just some slow tanks. Not going to be able to make a big impact in this trickle. I see Zapri perhaps looping around the high ground with a tactical visor. He's got nano visor active, jumps onto the point just in time to trigger overtime and gets the kills he's looking for. So Laser Kittens battle right back in.
And they've managed to work their way behind and almost back cap that one as X-Rox really far up. are gonna just get caught in some really awkward territory and picked off, and these spawns are gonna be really late for them. Cypher and Alexi, gonna be another 10 seconds before they're back in the fight. And that's gonna give Laser Kittens an extra, what, 20-25% that they really weren't owed.
It's true, they managed to sneak a win there, I think. Alex, getting the stagger on him at the beginning of that last fight was enough to tip the scales in Laser Kittens' favor. But ult-wise, we're looking at a favor for X-Rocks at this point. Fuse with that whole hog into, you know, some earth-shattered bodies could be quite effective. Got a bit of Reinhardt dueling taking place on the point itself, but the dash, excuse me, charge and pin comes in from Alex, still watching for that earth shatter, but no dangerous moments just yet. There he hits it right after Reinhardt goes down. Incredible value, gets both of the supports there, and that should be all she wrote for X-Rocks.
What a play from X-Rocks, coming in, using their ultimates again, super effective whenever they've got them online, the coordination really strong, but also Cooler was... So I don't want to use the word suffering because it was good for him, but he had the same situation that Nesh was in, where he's able to just reign with impunity. Like, he's got control of the skies. Zafra doesn't really have the sight lines or the freedom to be able to just pepper into him, and we are back to Garden.
Yep, back on the Garden level, trying to figure out which of these teams is actually better, as I still don't really know who's going to take this series. Every back-and-forth fight is basically hinging on a single ultimate here or there. Looks like the Roadhog ult combos, excuse me, the hook combos, really have not been coming into play as much as you would see on like a payload map, so I'm curious if Fuse may want to switch off as well, as Kib has already gone back to Genji just for this point. Pharahs are back in play, actually just Nesh versus Cooler's Soldier, so a bit of a different duel this time around. Cooler did lose the Pharah duel, I would say, probably 0-2 to Nesh in that previous encounter, so switching to Soldier this time should help things out.
And Gray on the Zen, that didn't really work out for them the first time, and they're taking this one a little slower. Even though they've got the dive composition, they've got this triple DPS for Laser Kittens, but they can't find an individual target to isolate because of the structure of this map and all of the objects blocking them. But as soon as somebody pokes their head, the initiation from Winghaven and Kib will probably come in.
The healing looks to be struggling to keep up a little bit for these tanks on the side of X-Rocks, but now they do get back to full. Cypher falling quite low, needs to bounce out just a little bit, but he's at 90 energy already, 80 plus at least, just zapping away at whatever happens to walk into his personal space. Alex falling quite low on Reinhardt, does end up dying to Kib, but this is the spark to ignite the fight. 100 energy for Cypher. He's just blasting everyone on the point. Winghaven falls super low, but does survive, finally goes down. Kib also in trouble, manages to get out of there. Nesh has Barrage generated already, but has about 2 HP to do it with, so he's going to fall as well. And X-Rocks off the back of Cypher and the healers, honestly. Looks like they're going to grab the point first. Transcendence does come out to delay things.
Transcendence being used along with that Dragon Blade, and Gray keeps Kib alive. Helps with the kill onto Fuse, but this Graviton coming in has captured both of their supports, and they're both going to fall down to Cooler and Alexi. And all of the ults coming in from X-Rocks feel like... I feel like Laser Kittens weren't anticipating it. They were just waiting for so long to get a really good opportunity to engage that they hadn't figured. They were giving so much spam and poke away that the ults were building up really quickly there for the entirety of X-Rocks, and they've got the more impactful ults, to say the least.
I didn't even see Nesh use the Barrage, but it couldn't have been that effective, unfortunately for his team. But X-Rocks, first points on the board, 2-1 lead here in Lijiang. They're looking to close the door on this series if they can. No ults to work with just yet. Winghaven does have the Primal Rage. He launches it. He's trying to knock some people off the map, but actually getting held at bay by the Whole Hog ultimate of Fuse. Great heads-up play there. Fuse actually almost died during that, but managed to keep Winghaven away from everyone long enough to potentially win the fight. Cooler takes out Gray, Zapri finds Fuse, Cypher's gonna go down to Winghaven, and looks like Nesh and Kib were able to put out enough damage on the point itself to get the ball rolling, and it should be a nice flip here. 40% for X-Rocks is all they're gonna get before Laser Kittens battle back.
As soon as these fights devolve and players start splitting off into individual factions all over the place on Garden, the triple DPS composition from Laser Kittens is able to isolate targets effectively, but when they're pushing around the back, as they are now with X-Rocks, it's very difficult to split off an individual player, and unless Nesh can put in a ton of damage onto somebody in particular or knock Alexi out of position, X-Rocks looking better and better.
Interesting play there from Alex. Does get the kill on Kib. I was worried he wasn't going to find any value for that Earthshatter, but 6v5 now means they're actually in a great position. Nano Visor coming out from Cooler. Take his position here. Takes out Nesh, no problem. There goes the Tracer as well. and the cohesion here from X-Rox really coming together. They didn't lose a single player during that fight. Of course, they did use some ultimates to get the job done, but they're standing tall now. They've got the benefit of being able to stare down the attackers trying to come back here, and another 15% in their pockets as a result. Nesh has swapped from the Pharah now officially over to D.Va to try and help shut down Roadhog and Soldier specifically.
I would have liked to see Gray switch over to Ana though to try and help Kid, because although he's got the Dragon Blade out, there's players falling and he really can't get anything done with it. He's got the sound barrier on him, but that Dragon Blade essentially got nothing done, and now they have to find individual targets to pick off just on their own. They're just running around kind of headless looking for players to pick off.
Man, I just gave the worst caster curse, spectator curse ever to Fuse. Fuse had basically the worst run of Roadhog that I've seen from him all day. Missed like three shots, missed the hook, and then got pulse bombed to death. But Cypher plants the Graviton Surge right onto the enemy tank. Steve is not quick enough to eat it up, but does absorb a lot of that damage. Cypher, extremely high energy, but extremely low health, does go down to Nesh. Also gets popped out of his suit there. Gray is going to fall before Transcendence is triggered, so still anybody's fight, but Laser Kittens do grab the point. Cooler is going to back off with Fuse there. It looks like they did lose enough people with Aang on that Lucio dying late that they're going to need to regroup. But they are, again, in one-and-done territory. All that means is if they win a single fight and flip that point back, it should be a done deal to take the map and the series in Game 4 of this BO3.
Dragonblade is up for Kib, and he's got the Transcendence to keep him alive, but on the other side, Cooler is very dangerously close to his, and Fuse has popped off a Whole Hog as well, so Windhaven falling immediately, and Gray and Kib combined for three at least, and damage onto more, and that's certainly going to tick things up into equal territory for the two teams, and it could come down to this. This could be the point at which it's decided between these two teams. If X-Rox can take control of the point, they will take the whole series.
They've got nothing to work with. They need a hog hook combo like crazy right now. So I'm going to watch Fuse, because he could actually be a huge swing hero as a Roadhog. If he can just hook someone into the pit or grab one of those squishy DPS quick enough, could mean the difference of failure or victory here. Lots of ults available on the other side. D.Va is going to launch her suit immediately, but gets hooked. That's the combo I'm looking for. Nesh goes down. Uses his ult and gets nothing for it. Great stuff there from Fuse. And now Genji's up in his face. Might be able to keep Kib out of the fight as well. Windhaven gets hooked in. Winston does not want to battle against the Roadhog. He's going to pop his Primal Rage to try and stay alive. Graviton Surge comes out for the red team. That's X-Rox already in control of the point. Roadhog barely saves his own life by getting inside against Windhaven's Primal Rage. But X-Rox gathering up all the kills on the point. It looks like they may have finally done it. 99% for Laser Kittens. Nesh is here out of the suit. Kib still alive. But is he on the point? He's going to try and touch in overtime. He's going to try and trigger it, but he's still 3v1 on the point, and his teammates are dying on the way in.
Hey, Kib making sure that he stays alive the whole time there just to make sure that the overtime is triggered. Windhaven backing onto the point, and Kib's taking a debuff from the Biotic Grenade and will get taken down. It looks like with Cooler's tactical visor up as well and the Whole Hog in position, this is going to be X-Rox just feasting on players who dare to run into their point, and they are going to take it. That's going to be 3-1 on that final decider, tiebreaker map even. And these two teams separated just by a hair's breadth, but separated they will be.
Kib will get play of the match honors despite losing the series, unfortunately. Some nice Dragonblade action here. Oh, and this is one of the ones that I missed earlier, so glad we get a chance to see it. Shutting down that TAC visor, of course, extremely important, not to mention the quad kill overall. But they do lose the map. Lijiang Tower goes.